some months ago, I think 6 months ago, we were traveling to Pune, northwest of India. So we were traveling to Pune and we had to break journey in Bangalore. So when we were going through the Bangalore airport, we found something very strange. We found a huge hoarding. It was an advertisement for the Samsung phone. And on top, there was a big bold caption. The caption on that advertisement was this. It says, "Rethink what a phone can do. Rethink what a phone can do." And we found it very amusing because at that particular time, there was a lot of problem associated with the Samsung, with one particular series of the Samsung phone. So much so that when we were traveling at every airport, when we enter the place, they would say, if you are having a Samsung phone of this particular type, please keep it aside. Again, during the screening, you know, we were checked for this, our bags were checked for this phone. And then even before boarding the aircraft, a third time an announcement was made, if you have this particular Samsung phone, you cannot travel with it. And one of the airport personnel was telling us that, you know, the problem is that, you know, you remember, do you know what was happening with the Samsung phone? The battery was exploding. So he said, you know, if you go with this phone, this particular type of phone, if you go into the aircraft and it explodes, there could be even a disaster. There could be a disaster. And therefore they said, you cannot carry this phone. So therefore I thought the caption was really amusing because it says, rethink what a phone can do. A phone can also be an explosive. As we were traveling, we were discussing, and then we realized that we were carrying something more dangerous than a Samsung phone. Every one of us, whether we realize it or not, we are carrying Jesus. And the Word of God says in Hebrews 12:29 that our God is not merely explosive, but that our God is a consuming fire. Our God is a consuming fire. You know what a consuming fire is? It keeps grabbing in everything around it. If there is a consuming fire, a fire that consumes, a strong fire, there is no way of putting it out. And we hear about this in the news all the time, forest fires. You know, acres and acres and perhaps huge, you know, mountain sides are just burnt up because of one little fire that became a consuming fire. The Word of God says, our God is a consuming fire, and not merely that, that it is He who dwells in you. In the first letter of John, chapter 4, verse 4, very easy to remember, 1 John 4:4. The Word of God says, He who is in you, there is something in you, there is a power in you. He who is in you is greater than he who is in the world. And this is an important revelation. God wants each one of us to know this. God wants each one of us to know this because you and I, we are familiar with the evil around us. Everywhere we look around, we can see things going wrong. Perhaps we're even fascinated by evil. If there is a horror movie, you know, we would all like to watch it because there's so much of drama, so much of dramatic things happening. There are perhaps thousands or millions of, you know, or websites who circulate fraud news, and all those news is something terrible, something disastrous about how someone got killed or murdered or some kind of strange phenomena, and we would love to read about these things. We are fascinated with evil. We are surrendered to evil. So many of us, if we on Wednesday we have something every week at the retreat center, we have something called counseling. So what happens when you go for counseling? You're ready to talk about everything going wrong in your life. We look at our family, we look at our parents. It's so easy for us to list out everything that has gone wrong. We look at our college or our course or even our nation, our political structures. We know that everything seems to be going wrong. When we look at ourselves, we know exactly what is wrong with us. Perhaps at every level, at our appearance, perhaps our way of talking, our way of thinking. We know our history, you know, when we look at our life journey, maybe some of you are just 15 or 18 or 20 or 30 or whatever. Every one of us, when we look at the years gone by, we know the things that have gone wrong. We know the things that have gone wrong. What people didn't do for us. How our parents let us down. And we become people who are subjected, we're kind of controlled by the evil that has happened to us. And that is why God wants us to know, evil is not as powerful as we imagine it to be. Evil is not as powerful as what it pretends to be. And we're so defeated. We're so defeated by the evil. You know, you look at your mark sheet and you look at what's missing. And you say, because of this, I could not get into this course. My parents have this kind of a broken marriage. Because of this, I don't have a hope for my future. We're very sure of the consequences of what has gone wrong in our lives. And therefore, we are afraid to be the power. We are afraid to recognize the power that is right there within us. And that's why in the first letter of John, chapter 3, the same apostle John is writing, 1 John chapter 3 verse 8, 1 John 3 8, he says, it is for this reason that God wants to reveal himself to you. 1 John 3 8, the word of God says, the Son of God has been revealed with one purpose, to destroy the works of evil. This retreat, we come for a retreat, we are here because we want to see God. We want to see the Son of God. And I'm not just saying, okay, seeing the face of God. To know what is the power of God. We want to see the power of God in our lives. And St. John says, when we see the power of God, the works of evil in our life will be destroyed. You know who this John was? The St. John who I'm going to talking about. Who was he? Bishop? Huh? Your parish priest? He was an apostle. And you know something special about him? He was the youngest apostle. He was a very young man. And Jesus chose him. And Jesus loved him. Because he made a big decision to leave everything for Jesus. He made a decision to leave everything. He was not one of those part-time followers. He was totally, seeking, daring and risking all his chances in life and following Jesus. And this John, he's known as a beloved disciple. He's the one whom Jesus loved in a special way because God has this preference. Almost it seems that way. God has this faith in young people. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. And it is he who writes, he writes bold statements. He's the one guy who defines God. Can God be defined? But John defines God. He's the one who says God is love. He's the one who says evil is destroyed. You know, even in Divine Retreat Center, we have a strong testimony of the power of the youth. You know how old this retreat center is? Can you guess? Maybe older than some of you. Huh? Make a guess. No fine for wrong answers. Yes. A little more than that. Last year we celebrated the Silver Jubilee. It is 26 years. And if you look at the history of this retreat center, it began this way. It was, we just had retreats in Malayalam. And then some people from Mangalore came here looking for a retreat, so they started a retreat in English, and then in Kannada, and Konkani, and then the other languages. And then in the year 19, so while the Malayalam retreat would receive thousands, the other languages would receive just a handful, and even English would receive about few hundreds. And then in 1995, they had something called the Youth Retreat. And I don't know how, but They boldly said this is going to be the first national youth retreat, 1995 October. I had not come here yet then. But in 1995 October, they had this youth retreat and about 500 youngsters came. And from that time, everything changed in this campus. The next year, in 1996, they had to shift. Earlier, the whole campus was on the other side of the highway. They had to take up this whole land. Because after the youth retreat, the numbers coming to the retreat center just doubled and tripled and many fold. And you know why? It's because when the youth came here, they could dare to make big decisions. Young people can be bold. So they made big decisions. They decided to trust in God 100% or nothing at all. And when they went back home, parents looked at them and said, oh, this change is going to last for 2 weeks. And then the parents saw it's lasting and lasting. 6 months later, they brought their parents for retreat. The next youth retreat, they came with classmates and friends and parents. And after that, the retreat center started regular couples retreat because they thought the parents need some special treatment. And you know, the director of the retreat center, Father Augustine, he always says, earlier, it was the parents who would bring the children to the church. And he said, now we can see it is the children, the youth, who are bringing the parents back to the church. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. So this is the power of youth to bring the whole family to salvation. And we begin over there. Today, in my family, if I can bring Jesus, I can be sure God will use me from there on to the ends of the earth. This is the promise of Jesus. Jesus says, you will be my witnesses in your home in Jerusalem. And he says, Jerusalem, he's talking about your home ground. And he says, from there, you are meant to be an instrument of God to the ends of the earth. Because our God is a consuming fire. Our God is a consuming fire. There's no limit to what God can do with your life. There's no limit. Your circumstances may be very ordinary, but we have a God who is extraordinary. You know, I remember this girl who had come here for retreat a couple of years ago. She had come here for retreat. And on the fourth day, she met me and she said, I'm very disturbed in this retreat. I want to go back. And I know I cannot go back, but I'm very upset. I was kind of fine before I came for the retreat, but the retreat has only made things worse for me. And I asked her why, what exactly is disturbing you. She said, you guys are talking about forgiveness, and I just cannot forgive my mother. And she began to explain. She said, a month before she came for this retreat, her mother left the house. Her mother disappeared from the house, and then a day or so later, they found out that the mother had run away with another man, a man who was a friend of the dad. And she said, I just cannot believe my mother did this to us. I cannot believe my mother did this to my dad. He's a very gentle person, very soft-spoken person. Till this day, he has not spoken a word against my mom. I can't believe she's done this to my brother and me. She had a younger brother. She said, we will grow up with a stigma of being known as the children. I would grow up known as a daughter of a woman who failed her husband, who failed in her marriage. She said, I can't believe my mother did this. Anyhow, when my mother did this, you know, the next day we were all shattered. We were feeling so humiliated because everyone was talking about it. She said, my dad came and told us, shall we go for a retreat? And both the kids said, yes, we want to go for a retreat. But they had their exams coming up, so they slotted this retreat for right after their exams. But as they were leaving the house, on the eve of the retreat, they were leaving the house to go to the railway station. The dad comes and tells the two kids, you know, we're going to a retreat center. And they say, miracles happen there. And he says, let's go and pray that a miracle happens and that mummy comes back home and we can be a family again. This girl said, I was so angry with my dad. I thought, what kind of man he is? He doesn't even have any kind of self-respect. She said, I wanted to fling my bags and tell dad, I'm not coming. But then she said, my dad is, I just can't think of hurting my dad. And I knew he was going through a lot and that's why I've come. And now at the retreat, she was feeling very nervous because she was seeing her dad praying all the time. He's praying during the sessions, praying during the break time. She said, I'm so scared a miracle will happen. I hope none of you are scared that miracles will happen. She said, if a miracle happens, if God is going to support my dad, and if my mom comes back home, I know one thing, I'm walking out. I don't know where I'm going to go, but I don't want to see the face of that lady, and I cannot forgive her. And this girl broke down in tears. And looking at her, it was very difficult. I told her, I said, see, I really understand what you feel, because a mother is like no other, right? A mother is a person you really respect, mother and father. But especially a mother is someone we look up to, someone we believe will stand by us. And especially when people we respect and trust and love, when these people let us down, it's so difficult. So I told her, I said, see, I know it's so difficult. Like, I can understand how you feel. I can understand it must be really difficult, but I know one thing, if I understand how difficult it is for you, if I understand how miserably your mother has failed you, I'm sure of one thing, God understands you better. God understands you better. God knows it must be so much more, how much more difficult it is. And I said, at the same time, God tells us we have to forgive. The Word of God, the Bible, right through is categorical about one thing, that God says, you must forgive. If you look at the scriptures, you know, Jesus gives us commandments. The Lord of spiritual masters who walked this earth, you know, a lot of great spiritual guys whom everybody admires. And they've given us a lot of nice wisdom. And it's nice to listen to them. It's nice to follow them. Maybe they have many followers. But Jesus gives commandments. And that is why Saint Teresa of Avila, you know, a saint known as a doctor of the church, very close to the Lord. She says, you know, Jesus, that's why you have very few friends. You are difficult. To be a Christian is not for weaklings. It's not for weaklings. To be a Christian, you need to be a toughie. Because Jesus gives a commandment. And the commandment is, you have to love one another. There's no other choice. There's no discount. I said, the Word of God is so clear. Jesus says clearly, every blessing is linked to forgiveness. Mark 11, verse 24 and 25. You know, Jesus gives a big promise, so important for us. If we believe in God, it's important for us. We believe in God, I come to God in prayer, expecting miracles and nothing less. And here Jesus says, when you come to pray, whatever you ask, it shall be yours. Do we believe that? Do you believe when you come to God, God will give you whatever you ask? Don't be dishonest. If we believed it, we would love to pray. We would love to pray. See, Jesus says it, you know, firstly because for Him nothing is impossible. Our God is a sovereign God, which means everything, every cell in your body. You have a cancer in your body, you don't have to worry. Every cell in your body, every drop of blood, it is there for God to heal. God has a power to heal it. Every detail of your life, every detail of your future, God can heal. God can make right. He's a God who holds the whole universe. What is it that is impossible for Him? And God keeps reminding us of this. In Jeremiah 32 verse 27, Old Testament, Jeremiah 32 verse 27, through the prophet Jeremiah, God is asking a question. Tell me, is there anything impossible for me? We all know this. We would have heard it at least. We may not know the book number, the chapter, the verse. That's not so important in fact. But we know that God says nothing is impossible for Him. And maybe we also say this. A friend comes with a problem, especially after this retreat, we'll tell them, don't worry, nothing is impossible for God. But you know, when God gives us His Word, He wants us to look at my life situation. My life situation, the problems in my family. The wounds that people have caused me, which seem impossible. I'm living in the shadow of those wounds. What does it mean? I'm living as a wounded person. My parents insulted me, or a teacher insulted me, and I feel so low about myself. I don't have the confidence to look at them perhaps. I don't have the confidence before an authority figure. A friend betrayed me. I loved this friend. I gave 100%. And now I am so wounded because that person made a fool of me. And today I'm afraid in all my relationships. I'm afraid of being hurt. I'm afraid of being generous. So we have people who are living by these wounds. And here Jesus says, nothing is impossible. Whatever you ask in prayer, it shall be yours. And you know why he says that? Whatever you ask, it's an invitation. Ask God. Don't be so sophisticated. I don't ask God for anything. I'm very decent. The fact is we're very scared because if I ask and God doesn't give, he'll feel disappointed. Hallelujah. 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 God wants us to ask. You have a problem, ask the Lord. You know why? Because he loves to give. How many of you have fallen in love? So you know something about when you fall in love, you know the usual thing is, really in love, the quality of love is you want to give. You're always thinking how to give, what to give that person, how to make this person happy. A friend of mine was getting married. So she's telling me, you know, Maria, it's so costly to be in love. Right? You need a credit card. She said, ever since I fell in love and we've been engaged, I'm going shopping more often. And she said, I go to the shop and I think, what is the best gift I can give him? She said, I'm buying the gift and then when I go to him, you know, he will tell me something like, why are you wasting money? He's not the gifts kind of person. She said, I go on and then I tell him, you know, I need to find a reason. So I tell him, you know what? It's the 30th day since we exchanged numbers. It's the 40th day since we smiled at each other. Some people come to the retreat to first take the phone numbers. They're having a directory. Don't bother giving it to them. So I told her, you know, 30th day, 40th day, this sounds like these death memorials. In the South, you know, when someone dies, you have a 30th day mass and a 40th day remembrance and all that. She's a close friend of mine, so I could joke. But what is it? When I'm in love, I'm looking how to give. And God loves you. Maybe even you don't love yourself. Maybe you don't love yourself and so you're so sure God cannot love me. Maybe your parents don't love you. They're so fed up of you. That's what you think. No matter what, your God loves you so much. He says, whatever you ask, it shall be yours. And that is why he says, whatever you ask, it shall be yours. But then he says, before you come to pray, your gate pass to pray, he says, you have to forgive. If you forgive, you're opening your life to power. When I ask God, he's going to respond to me. You're opening your life to the blessings of God. And we need to make a choice. Do I want to hold on to the past or do I want the blessings of God? Do I want to be a person who's linked to the most influential power, God? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Again, Jesus says, you have to forgive if you want your sins to be forgiven. You know, all of us. I don't have to be secretive about this. And every one of us know how much we have failed God. We have failed God. We're not perfect. And perhaps we've gone very, very low. We're sinking with sin. And we feel, every one of us, we feel bad about it. Maybe we try to cover it up and say, I don't care. Maybe I'm trying to say, oh yes, you know, everybody does this. Everyone's into pornography. I'm into pornography. So what? Maybe, oh yes, I can say I use swear words, but then, you know, my parents are using it all the time. I smoke and drink, so what? My mom or my dad, whoever's doing it, when they're stressed, they do it, I do it. We may have our reasons, but we know very well it's a stinking sin. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. And for God, he's not afraid of stink. He's not afraid of grease. He is not afraid of our dirt. If you take me to a place where there's a lot of crap, I wouldn't want to go there because I'm afraid of getting dirty. But that's me and that's not God. God doesn't care for the grime in your life. He doesn't care about the grease in your past. That grease that is just not going away. You want to get it out of your fingers, you're not able to get it. You want to come out of pornography, you're not able to. You know, you want to come out of this abusive, ugly relationship, you're not able to. For God, it doesn't matter. He can wash you completely clean. And that's what He tells us. Even if your sins are as red as crimson, as a particular shade, you cannot remove the stain of it. He says, I will make you white as snow. This is the confidence of God. He says, whatever your sins are, I will forgive. On one condition. And it is not the kind of sin. It's not whether you've done a first degree sin or a second degree sin or a third degree sin. On one condition, and that condition is, if you forgive, you will be forgiven. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah.